Welcome to Green Time. I'm host Don Fitz. This episode, we're going to be talking about strange financing in St. Louis. What's happening with St. Louis, City of St. Louis dollars? With me, I have a couple of people who have thought about that. I have Jerome Bauer, who is a Green Party candidate for Comptroller of the City of St. Louis. And I also have Quinn Parks, who is the Green Party candidate for Alderman for Ward 7. I want to welcome both of you to Green Time. Now, Jerome, could you tell us a little bit about TIFs? That's tax incremental financing. Do I have that correct?
Yes, you have that correct.
Okay. What is it?
Well, basically, a TIF is when you borrow against expected future property tax or tax increases to fund a project. And these are intended to revitalize supposedly blighted areas. Who decides what's blighted and what's not? Well, that's one of the reasons why we call this panel today strange financing, because it's not usually very transparent, and that's one of the problems that so many people have with TIFs. Where does the money really go? But basically, the property taxes will be frozen at the beginning of the TIF, and then after a certain period, maybe 2 or 3 years, or in some cities as long as 20 years, then the added value will be recovered in tax. And along the way, sometimes additional levies will be required to help out the developer. For example, if they need a little bit of extra money to fund some extra policemen on the East Loop, then they may ask homeowners within a certain distance of the Loop Trolley to pay, to vote on whether they want to pay that extra amount. That was on my ballot not long ago. I would have voted against it, except that my house was just a little bit too far from the TIF district.
Okay, really don't know about what the future of the TIF is going to be. There's an assumption that the value of the property is going to go up, and if that doesn't happen, well, then the taxpayers are left footing the bill.
Right, and basically, the big problem with TIF, TIFs were invented in 1953 in California. They're banned in California now, although all the rest of the 50 states have them, and other countries have similar programs. But basically, not to put too fine a point on it, they're gentrification programs. The whole point is that you drive up the real estate values, and all manner of low-income people have their property taxes increased, and they have their homes zoned in tax sales, and that happened to my next-door neighbor. Okay. If we'd found out about it sooner, we could have saved his house. I could have, I would have been happy to take up a collection.
Let's get over to tax abatements. Quinn, could you tell us a little bit about tax abatements and what your concerns with them are?
Well, my concerns about tax abatements is they're used entirely too liberally for commercial properties, especially large multinational corporate development programs, like some of the high rises we've been seeing in the news in the Central West End. And what we're not using them for is to help the development of our neighborhoods, mostly on the north and south side, where they could be used for shoring up the neighborhoods, increasing our percentage of homeowners in those neighborhoods.
That would really be helpful.
Certainly. You can really go down these streets in St. Louis and you can figure out what's, a rental and what's a homeowner, almost exclusively by the generation the windows were manufactured. That's a rental. Somebody takes care of that property.
So there's nothing to prevent a tax abatement from being used to help an individual homeowner. It's just that that's not where it goes.
Well, that's not where the priority seems to be in St. Louis. The priority for these tax abatements have been mostly in the Central Corridor, and mostly used for commercial properties or condos or high-rise apartment living.
So the thing that tax abatements have in common with TIFs is they tend to be used as a way for people who have a lot of money to get even more money, and they tend not to be used for people who have a very small amount of money. Okay, Jerome, could you tell us a little bit about the Delmar Loop Trolley in the NGA campus?
Yeah, I'll tell you a little bit more about the Delmar Loop Trolley, but before I do that, while we're still on the topic of tax abatements, it has been proposed that we use tax abatements to help out homeowners whose property values are being driven up and as a result of a TIF. For example, in the Paul McKee Northside Regeneration Project, and the Alderwoman, Tamika Hubbard, suggested that that was not an appropriate use of TIF money. I think nothing could be more appropriate, you know, until we ban TIFs. I mean, at the very least, we can use them to bail out homeowners, you know, a people's bailout instead of a corporate bailout. So I'm in favor at this point of just banning TIFs, but, you know, until we do that, we can at least use them to bail out the people instead of the
I think TIFs were born of the idea of indefinite growth, which is a very American idea that there will always be more profits next year. We will always grow the value.
There's always plenty of fossil fuels, and we should burn them as rapidly as we can.
Right, and that's the idea of TIF. TIF only works if the properties continue to gain value. Gain value against what? You know, eventually it becomes pointless.
Okay. Let's get back to those examples. Jerome, what can you tell us about the loop trolley?
Okay.
Which is supposed to go online sometime in 2017 or certainly by 2018.
It's almost complete now. Well, loop trolley, I remember I think the very first St. Louis on the Air proposal of the loop trolley project back in the early 2000s. Joe Edwards and a friend were on the program, and they were talking about, you know, we got to put in this trolley because we want to revive it, want to bring back trolleys in the city. And this is much better than just
putting in a circulator.
because, you know, it's a classic, you know, thing. You get these oil
because
loop trolleys.
Because I like trains.
I like trains. Pretty much that was it, yeah. You know, we want to, but anyway, somebody said, well, can't you just put in a circulator bus painted like a trolley? And he said, no. The reason that we want to put in the trolley is because it's permanent infrastructure, and we're going to get businesses growing around the stops, the trolley stops. Okay, so basically a gentrification project.
Right.
And the loop trolley is funded partly by a TIF, partly by tax revenues from the city of St. Louis, partly by a big grant from the National Transportation Administration, and a $250,000 contribution from Washington University in St. Louis. And right now they're putting in their off-campus dormitories right along the trolley route. Right now the trolley will not go anywhere where WashU students really want to go. But the idea
is that there's
trolley stops all along, you know, to Points East and then the Crossroads Academy, the prep school, halfway in between Delmar and the History Museum. So it's going to go to those locations, and it will take rich Washington University students and their parents and a lot of rich tourists to the shops that don't yet exist. So once
so
again,
could
we're
be,
borrowing.
Could be. Okay, so we know that the trolley could be a boondoggle. Tell us about NGA. What does NGA stand for?
Okay, well, NGA is National Geospatial Intelligence Agency. And Lacey Clay and Mayor Slay and a lot of other people, Ryder Cruson among them, really kind of bent over backwards to keep the National Geospatial Agency from moving to Scott Air Force Base over across the river. So they gave them a big sweetheart deal involving settling on some of the land in Paul McKee's redevelopment agency area. And originally it was to have overlapped with the Pruitt-Igoe site, the site of the demolished public housing project. Recently, though, Paul McKee bought the entire Pruitt-Igoe site and is planning to put a 500, housing unit development in that area. And the National Geospatial Agency campus will be a little bit to the north. But it's all, you know, in the Paul McKee redevelopment area.
Basically, again, it's the case of one person getting enormously rich.
Yeah, getting enormously rich at the taxpayers.
Hoarding land. Right.
Okay. Yeah. And I
and
first
driving we, the value of it down.
We first found out about this in 2009 when somebody discovered that somebody was buying up just random parcels of land in the north side, and they found out it was Paul McKee. Mm-hmm. And I remember going to one of the very first Northside Community Benefits Alliance meetings, and I was invited to speak because my home was in foreclosure at the time, so I really had a connection with the people who were living there. I did not see blight. You know, in order to get a TIF, it's really supposed to be to develop, quote-unquote, a blighted area. And this picnic was on the grounds of the Shining Light Pentecostal Church, and I did not see a blighted community. I saw a thriving, vibrant African-American faith community. I did not see blight. And I was given this button by a libertarian friend of mine who's a supporter of the Northside Community Benefits Alliance and a strong opponent of eminent domain abuse. And that is another big problem.
We're going to need
the condemning land.
That we're going to need to take a break, and we're going to save a couple of announcements, and we'll be back in just a minute.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Welcome back to Green Time. I'm host Don Fitz. We're talking about strange finances in the city of St. Louis. With me, I have Jerome Bauer, who is a candidate for comptroller in the city of St. Louis, and also Quinn Parks, who is a candidate for alderman in Ward 7. Quinn, we all know where the city of St. Louis is, so I'm not going to ask this to Jerome, but I do want to ask you, where is Ward 7?
Ward 7 is a pretty sizable beast right in the center of the city proper.
Okay.
It includes downtown and the Arch, part of Laclede's Landing, and coming down into the southern part of the city includes neighborhoods like Soulard, part of Lafayette Square, McKinley Heights, and bits and pieces of Fox Park as well.
Okay, great. Now tell me this. We've talked about TIFs and we've talked about tax abatements. And one thing that a lot of people are concerned about is sports stadiums. What's your thought about sports stadiums and how they should be financed and who should get the money off of them and everything?
You know, there's the perfect world of sports stadiums, which would be complete public ownership. You know,
right.
That we went to Major League Soccer. We made an honest offer about we'll build the stadium, we'll own the team, and then we'll reap the profits.
That makes sense to me. I mean, if I'm going to start a business,
I
don't want you to pay for my business if
but
I start it.
But that is certainly out of fashion these days. So generally now we have two choices. Mm-hmm. We can either go in with a private developer, mm-hmm. where we're putting up some of the money for a stadium. It's generally privately owned until it's kind of old and an eyesore, and then we own it. Once it's a pink elephant in 20 years. So that is the most popular way to do it. And these sports teams, you know, they make the sale. And that's what they're doing. They're salesmen. They're saying, hey, your city can be better with our brand next to it. And they're making the sale, and they're trying to get us to open our wallets and pay for it. So we can either call their bluff and be like, you know, there's just not going to be a soccer stadium here in St. Louis until you pay for it. Mm-hmm. Or we can offer some public financing with some real benefits to the city. I would be interested in offering some public financing to a stadium if I knew for a fact that every single job associated with that stadium, whether it be the food service people or the people working in the parking lots, was going to be paid at $15 an hour.
We could tie that to a fund. If they want funding, they would have to do that.
You know, tell me that you're going to have local food shops in that stadium, mm-hmm. instead of simply just calling up Sodexo Marriott and having it staffed. Mm-hmm. You know, tell me that the benefit for my community is going to be far and wide. And then we can talk about investing with you.
So this seems to be related very much to building up neighborhoods in the city of St. Louis. It's kind of hard to invest a lot of money into neighborhoods if you've just spent all of your money attracting sports stadiums
to
have a big
name.
That's
St. Louis for you,
isn't it? Okay, so do you agree with my... Okay, so tell me, if we weren't throwing away millions and millions of dollars on sports stadiums and sports teams, how should we use that money in the city of St. Louis?
Well, like I talked about earlier, it really is about home ownership rates. One of the greatest assets St. Louis has is this wonderful, old, historic brick housing stock. Mm-hmm. And we need to invest in that. We have a lot of buildings that need renovated and a lot of commercial spaces that need renovated. Mm-hmm. You know, so much of these TIFs and tax abatements are involved with new construction. But there's so many empty buildings in this city.
That's right. And you can rehab most buildings cheaper. Not a warehouse. A warehouse is more expensive.
Right.
But for other buildings besides a warehouse, it's cheaper and it's more environmentally friendly to actually rehab.
We should be concentrating on fixing the assets we have instead of more of a bulldoze and rebuild concept that St. Louis has had since...
It just pains me to drive by some of the houses in St. Louis and look at them and see if they were tuck pointed, if they were kept up, if they were rehabbed. This building would last for another 100-150 years. But if they're just let there to rot, you know they're not going to stay up for 10 or 15 years.
You know, it pains me to look at the old maps before the interstate was put in. And I think of all the buildings and neighborhoods that existed and thrived in St. Louis and were totally bulldozed for basically redevelopment ideas. The politicians of the day, 50, 60, 70 years ago, thought, hey, we're going to make St. Louis thrive by putting in these huge commercial areas by the river. Mm-hmm. How did it work out? That commercial area by the river, it's in the 7th Ward, and it's struggling, you know?
Well, let me ask you this. The flip side of homeowners is there's people in St. Louis who lose their home, and they don't have any place to go.
Certainly.
Now, at the break, you told me it's not a question of sports stadiums or
homeless
shelters. But so I won't say either or. But what do you think should be done about investing in homeless shelters, and especially a homeless shelter such as New Life?
Well, preferably we would be investing in the homeless and not in the homeless shelters.
Right.
Preferably we would be investing in finding ways to permanently home these folks that need help. Mm-hmm. You know, in a compassionate society, at some point, you have to stop blaming the chronic homelessness on the people. Mm-hmm. And you just have to help them up. There's no other way. You know, poverty is a cycle. And eventually, you get down to the point where it's just a full-time job to keep your calories up, to keep your hygiene well enough to where they'll let you go into the McDonald's and use the bathroom. Mm-hmm. And these sort of things dominate your whole day. And once you're there, there's really no getting up without help. And as a city, we need to focus on that. And as a region, we need to focus on that. You know, too much of the burden of the homeless in this area is put on the city.
Right.
You know, when you're out on the street and you're talking to this population and you ask them where they're from, very few comparatively grew up their whole lives on the street of city proper. You know, a lot of them came from Metro East or Metro North or West County. You'd be amazed.
So what we really need is a statewide and a nationwide policy.
Well,
of dealing with homelessness.
You know, in this situation, as with a lot of situations like the metro expansion and many other things, we need greater regional leadership. You know, we're a fragmented area, not just with the state line, but also with the city-county divide.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Jerome, I wanted to ask you, when we're talking about TIFs, we never did really, you started to mention the possibility of banning TIFs outright. Mm-hmm. Now, what would we do if we banned TIFs? What could we replace that with?
Well, I think we should replace it with all sorts of cooperative business models. And I have a story to tell about my most recent trip to my doctoral alma mater, the University of Pennsylvania. When I went to school there, it was a really rough working class neighborhood with a lot of university people living in the neighborhood as well. We'd hear the gunshots going off. There was a pit bull place right across from my house until the neighbors banded together and ran them out and put a Pentecostal church in its place. So it was that sort of rough neighborhood. When I went back for a Cooperative Food Empowerment Directive Leadership Summit, it was as if the whole neighborhood had been made new again, but it was exactly the same neighborhood. The historic buildings were all there. All of my favorite places were still there. The Anarchist Collective, the A Space, it was still there. Lame Duck Bookstore, used bookstore, was still there. All the corner grocery stores still there. There was one chain store, Subway sandwich shop, but it was in a historic building and it looked like it belonged there. I was told that it was about to go out of business because nobody ate there, but it was there. And it was, they didn't tear anything down to put this Subway sandwich shop in. And best of all, the Mariposa Food Co-op, which had been a little hole-in-the-wall food buying place with a seven-member collective running it for 30 years, had moved into a big renovated bank building.
Drum, we only have a minute left, so how was all
well,
this done?
Well, this is Ralph. This was done because the University of Pennsylvania took the initiative and consulted everybody, and I rather mischievously dropped the G word, gentrification, expecting a chorus of denunciations, which is what you would get if you dropped the G word around Washington University or St. Louis University. And instead, everybody said, this was done right. The University of Pennsylvania deserves credit for this because everybody was consulted, nobody was excluded. A rising tide lifts all boats. And to them, gentrification was not a dirty word. So they're right and wrong ways to do this.
We're gonna need to take a break and then we'll get back after the break to finish up, okay? We'll be back in just a minute. Welcome back to Green Time. I'm host Don Fitz. This episode, we're talking about strange finances in the city of St. Louis. I have with me Quinn Parks, a Green Party candidate for Alderman Ward 7. And I have with me Jerome Bauer, who is the Green Party candidate for Comptroller. Okay, Jerome, what were you telling us about? We just have a few seconds to end up the story about University of Pennsylvania and gentrification.
Okay, well, I had a long interview with the grocers of the Mariposa Cooperative Food, the cooperative grocery, and they gave us some good advice. If we want to do that here, make sure to have a cooperative business association, a local St. Louis area cooperative association, so that cooperatives can cooperate with other cooperatives. And they also asked us to start a Midwestern Cooperative Food Empowerment Directive here in St. Louis. And when I ran for Comptroller the first time, I wrote that into our platform.
Okay, so having cooperatives can be very important for the city of St. Louis development. Quinn, what are the most important points you would like to leave the viewer with?
Well, I would like you to check out my website.
And what is that website?
It is Parks, the number 4, Ward, the number 7.com.
Parks4Ward7.com with two numbers in it.
Yes. And check out our website. There's a space for you to donate to our campaign. And also you can link to our Facebook page and see how we're updating the campaign daily.
Okay. And what do you think the most important thing that you said in just a few seconds about St. Louis? What would you like to see?
My campaign is about equality and compassion.
Great. Okay, I got to cut you off there. And I want to thank both Jerome and Quinn. And I want to thank our viewers for tuning in. Please look at us the same time next week.